Hi there, welcome. I'm excited to talk with you about the key reasoning concept of problem representation. I'm Denise Connor, and I'm the theme lead for CMC and direct the doctor block. So you've heard the term problem representation probably by many names. Dr. Lucy likes to call it the patient illness script. You may hear the one-liner, the summary statement, the assessment, and we're going to dive a little bit deeper into those concepts to give you a little bit more of a subtle sense of what they mean and where they belong in your reasoning process. So our objectives today are just really two things. The first thing I want you to be able to do is describe the purpose of an evolving problem representation within the context of the clinical encounter. And then secondly, I want you to be able to describe how the problem representation fits into your written and oral presentation. So let's get started. So the first thing to think about is data gathering. Your history and physical exam is probably the place where the problem representation is going to be the most important for you as a tool to help you take a hypothesis-driven history and exam. Remember that when you're with a patient, you're going to start out with one sense of what their problem is, and that's going to evolve throughout the course of your data gathering. And as that problem evolves, the problem you're trying to solve, your new sense of that problem will inform the types of historical questions and the physical exam maneuvers that you may want to perform with that patient to get at and differentiate the potential causes of that problem. So let me give you an example. Say you're with a patient, and after the first couple of sentences that they get out, you have a sense that maybe you're dealing with acute shortness of breath. And you realize that time course and tempo is really important with shortness of breath, and so you dig down a little bit further. And after a few more minutes, you realize actually it's not acute shortness of breath, it's really subacute shortness of breath, and this person has been having fevers. So now my sense of this problem is really a little bit different and more specific than it was when I started. And that's going to inform my next set of questions. So if the patient has a fever, maybe I'm wondering whether they're immunosuppressed, and would that change the differential diagnosis that they might have? It turns out, yes, this problem is subacute shortness of breath plus fever in a patient with AIDS. And now, as you can see, I'm kind of solving a much more specific problem, and the next historical question I ask, the next physical exam maneuver I do, will be informed by what this problem is. And so remember that in sort of the foundational part of building your reasoning skill set, we're doing this explicitly. We're often pausing during a history, we're pausing during an exam and asking you to give us your problem representation. It's a little artificial, and it's meant to be practice for something that's going to eventually be an internal process. So one day when you're sitting with a patient in the clinic, as the patient's talking with you, in your mind, you're going to be tracking and continuously updating the problem representation in your mind, and that's going to allow you to take a better history and do a better physical exam. All right, so at the end of the data gathering, you need to actually talk about this patient with your team. So the verbal output that you're gonna have after you've completed your history and physical exam is a summary statement. And that summary statement within it is embedded your kind of final problem representation. And it's contextualized with a little bit of additional information that's going to set you up to give your audience a prioritized differential diagnosis. So the summary statement you can think of as the launching pad for your prioritized differential diagnosis. People that listen to that statement at the beginning of your assessment and plan, you're going to say that one-liner, and your team's going to be able to imagine what your most likely diagnosis is based on that summary statement. So in this example, we had a series of problem representations, and then at the end we sat down, we wrote this sentence, and this is what we presented to our team. Ms. Jones is a 58-year-old woman with AIDS and prior TB exposure with subacute progressive shortness of breath, fevers, weight loss, productive cough, and right upper lobe consolidation on chest x-ray. So we've really contextualized Ms. Jones's problem, and we've crystallized what we think is most important from the data gathering that we just did. And notice that in this one-liner or this summary statement, we have a lot of key elements that we've discussed. So the first thing we have is she's a 58-year-old woman with AIDS and TB exposure. So that is her epidemiology and her risk factors for disease. Then we have that she has subacute progressive symptoms. So now we have a time course as well as a tempo of her symptoms. And then we have all this information here, the shortness of breath, the fevers, et cetera. And those are elements that we thought were really important in terms of her clinical syndrome. So we've put all the right information into this summary statement so that the listeners can imagine what our first most likely diagnosis might be, because they might recognize this as a pattern. The important thing to realize is that this is an art, and that you're going to get better at figuring out what belongs in this statement the more patients you see, the more medical knowledge you have. We're going to be doing a lot of practice with this to get you comfortable with the concept and to help you remember what the key kind of building blocks for a good summary statement might be. But it's okay that at the beginning of this process, you might not always know of all the data I just gathered what's most relevant. And that's a big kind of learning opportunity for you. And just as a reminder, not only is that summary statement what you're going to say to your team at the beginning of your assessment and plan when you're giving your oral presentation, it's also the sentence you're literally going to write out at the beginning of your assessment and plan in your medical note. So another example here, Mr. Chen is a 68-year-old man with COPD with acute shortness of breath, increased sputum, diffuse wheezing, and a clear chest x-ray. So just another encapsulation of a problem representation that now has maybe a little bit more context and information included to give you a sense of what my most likely diagnosis is. So that reminds me to say a couple more things about this summary statement. The first thing is that it's, like I said, it's an art, and different clinicians like to hear it in different ways. So when you get to the clinical world, you may find that some attendings, residents, and fellows want you to actually include the most likely diagnosis right within that first sentence, while others may like you to wait till the next breath when you go through your differential diagnosis. So for example, you might end up saying, Mr. Chen is a 68-year-old man, most concerning for a COPD exacerbation. Those kind of details don't really change the goal of the statement, which always is a way to set up your prioritized differential diagnosis. And remember that the point of this is different from the point of the earlier iterations of the problem representation, which were more about helping you to feedback into your history and physical exam. And with that, that's all I have for you. Thanks for listening. Please feel free to email me with questions. I love talking about reasoning, and I look forward to seeing you apply this in our reasoning sessions.